The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And I call at question one, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And on behalf of the Chamber, let me take this opportunity to welcome you back to your post. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that Police Scotland is considering closing more than 40 police buildings.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, responsibility for the police estate is a matter for the Chief Constable and is subject to regular Scottish Police Authority scrutiny. These proposals are now subject to consultation, and I know that Police Scotland are keen to hear about any local concerns. The Police Scotland Estate Strategy, published in 2019, recognises that much of the police estate was outdated and underused. In delivering the strategy, Police Scotland has prioritised co-location with partner organisations in modern, well-equipped accommodation, with more than 60 co-locations delivered across the country thus far.
Liam Kerr.
In Aberdeen, it's reported that five stations, that's Maastricht, Rosemount, Seton, Windhill and Torry, may all close. Now, SPF General Secretary David Kennedy says these closures are due to a lack of funding from the Scottish Government and will be devastating to community policing. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the police, and has she demanded that today's SNP budget avoids inflicting yet more pain on our police, our communities and Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will of course leave it to the Deputy First Minister in the not too distant future to outline this government's budget, which of course will prioritise public services. And as Justice Secretary, I am aware that the number one priority of any government is to protect the public. It is of course a matter for consultation. Mr Kerr and other colleagues in the North East will want to feed the very specific comments around any proposed closures in Aberdeen or elsewhere. I know that Police Scotland stand ready to engage on the detail of any local concerns. With respect to funding, I would like to advise Mr Kerr that through capital receipts, Police Scotland has invested £31 million back into the police state from relinquishing disused or old buildings. And I would also remind them that this government has continued to make year-on-year investment in policing, including the doubling of the capital budget since 2016-17.
Liam Kerr.
The police do well with what they are given by this government, but due to slashed police budgets in September, Aberdeen was also chosen as the guinea pig for a pilot scheme in which some crimes in the city will not be investigated. So, Cabinet Secretary, what criteria will be used to judge if that pilot has been a success? What impact has it had on Aberdeen's communities? And is it the Cabinet Secretary's intention that the pilot be rolled out across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, of course, Mr Kerr once again refers to operational matters for Police Scotland, and I would like to remind him that in terms of this financial year, this government has increased the police budget by over 6%. That is equivalent to an additional £80 million this year. No one for a minute demurs from the consequences of more than a decade of Tory austerity. But this government will stand
Cabinet
proud
Secretary,
by the decisions that we have made. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I would be grateful if members would restrain and not... Members, let's not have speaking while we're sedentary. Mr McPherson, Ben McPherson.
Thank you, President Officer. As this consultation is undertaken and the Chief Constable and SPA give this matter careful consideration, does the Minister agree with me, the Cabinet Secretary agree with me, that it's important that we consider that there are high maintenance costs and environmental inefficiencies in much of our policing estate, including in my own constituency, and actually to be able to enable 21st century policing and opportunities for collaboration, co-locating with local partners, there are potential benefits here for the public in rationalising the police estate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I do very much agree with that. We all want our public services to be efficient and to be effective and to be accessible. Co-location with suitable partners makes best use of the public sector estate and importantly offers opportunity for increased visibility, closer working and increased collaboration between Police Scotland and partners. Police Scotland has now over 60 examples of successful co-location. One of the best examples is, of course, in my own constituency, the West Lothian Civic Centre sees Police Scotland working alongside the local authority, Crown Office, Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, the Scottish Children's Reporters Administration, Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And all of this seems to me, Presiding Officer, to be the best use of public resources at these straitened times at the hands of the Tory government elsewhere.
Colleen McNeill.
To close 29 stations is unprecedented and it will impact on communities across Scotland at a time where confidence in police is falling, and stations such as Leith in Edinburgh and Stuart Street in Glasgow have high usage. Stuart Street in Glasgow, a city centre station, is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's difficult to see how the city centre of Glasgow could be adequately policed without Stuart Street. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the source of the issue is a poor capital budget settlement for Police Scotland? And I ask specifically what representations the Cabinet Secretary has made to prevent this mass closure of police stations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it's important to recognise that the police presence in our communities is not solely defined by buildings, but instead it's defined by the nature of the work and the nature of engagement. And of course, the rollout of mobile technology has of course changed the way in which police officers work. She of course raises very specific matters in relation to police stations in the centre of Glasgow. I am sure that Ms. McNeill will make her feelings known as part of the public consultation. And as we all know, Presiding Officer, that capital has not been inflation-proofed by the UK government, but nonetheless, this government has more than doubled the capital budget for policing since 2017-18.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I don't think it's the co-location that's the issue. The issue that people have is that if the new facilities are not true like-for-like replacements, we may, for example, see loss of facilities such as holding cells. In the case of Greenock, for example, this may mean officers will have to go to Govan or Clydebank with the arrested or the accused. Can I ask if the Cabinet Secretary shares my concern that modernisation or so-called rationalisation must never come at the expense of public safety or indeed officer productivity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, if Mr Green was aware of the publication of the news release by Police Scotland last week, he would have seen that the safety and well-being of their officers and staff was very much paramount and is not the only reason, but is one of the reasons for driving them forward in terms of implementing an estate strategy that ensures that not only do the public have fit-for-purpose facilities, but also the officers and their staff have fit-for-purpose facilities as well.
Thank you. Move to question number two, and I call Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the rollout and use of tasers within Police Scotland in light of reports that they've been used 131 times and discharged 9 times against children since 2018.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the provision of tasers and the deployment of specially trained officers or STOs is an operational matter for Police Scotland. Since the initial deployment of STOs in June 2018, Police Scotland received approval from the Scottish Police Authority's Police and Performance Committee in September 2021 to enhance its taser capability to around 2,000 STOs. This additional rollout is expected to be completed by April 2024. The use of or the presence of a taser provides officers with an option of de-escalating a situation more quickly, ensuring the safety of the public and police officers. Every incident attended is judged on its own merits, and every discharge of a taser is reported to the Independent Police Investigations and Review Commissioner. Of the 9 times a taser was discharged against a child under the age of 18, 7 were judged proportionate and 2 remain under investigation by the Commissioner.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? When tasers were rolled out at 2 police divisions across Scotland in 2018, the public was assured the large rise in discharges of weapons was not expected. Since then, 20 people have been left with injuries, and now we hear tasers have been used 131 times against children, with the taser actually discharged against a child, as the Cabinet Secretary acknowledged, on 9 separate occasions. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that this points to a slide towards an enforcement model of policing, and will she consider scaling back the deployment of tasers in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me stress to Mr MacArthur that no one wants to use a taser on anybody, and particularly a child. The discharge of a taser is always a last resort. Each incident must be treated on its own merits, and it's vital that the threat or risk posed to the wider population, a police officer, as well as the child or young person themselves, that is the primary consideration. Each officer is trained and aware of their responsibilities. As I said, since 2018, there have been 9 occasions where an individual under 18 has involved the actual use or discharge of a taser, and that on each occasion that incident is referred to the Independent Investigation and Review Commissioner.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary again for that response? And she acknowledges the use of tasers on children does give rise to particular concerns. Not only are children at increased risk of long-term physical injury from high-voltage shocks, but sustained psychological trauma can also result from such encounters with police. Last week, this Parliament unanimously agreed legislation incorporating the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child into Scots law, with UN representatives, Scottish children rights campaigners and others calling for a complete ban on the use of tasers against children. Will the Cabinet Secretary now give that proposal proper consideration?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I mean, I hope to give some reassurance to Mr MacArthur. There are, of course, 2 pieces of legislation that are highly relevant in this regard. Tasers are prohibited weapons under the 1968 firearms legislation, which is reserved, and any police force wishing to deploy tasers can only do so with approval from the Home Secretary. He is right to point to the unanimous passing of UNCRC legislation by this Parliament, and we hope that royal assent will be achieved at the start of next year. And that bill will require all public authorities to report on a regular basis how they are complying with the requirements of UNCRC with respect to devolved duties. It may be of some reassurance to Mr MacArthur, and I'm happy to write to him in detail, that the training in and around the deployment of tasers is robust and it is rigorous, it is scenario-based, and there is also the role of the National Advisory Group, which includes advocacy organisations in relation to human rights and children's rights, and that informs the Equality and Human Rights Impact Assessment.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. I thank for the response to this question. But in the previous response, the Cabinet Secretary confirmed that the taser regulations are in fact reserved. So the UNCRC that we passed so successfully here cannot be used by children. So will the government take steps in the near future to ensure that the UNCRC notifies this specific element so that young people who are affected in this way, as is the call for the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child, to seek protection under their human rights here in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, this government will always strive to advance the rights of a child. It is also the right of every child to be protected in very difficult circumstances. And I will, of course, I'm happy to correspond with Mr Whitfield and indeed any other MSP on this matter, because I'm conscious that time is running out, Presiding Officer, and there are some complexities on this matter. But if I could give some reassurance in and around the training that police officers receive on this matter to deal with highly fluid situations where they have a duty to protect police officers, members of the public, and not least a child or young person who is at risk or at distress.
And Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Discharging a taser carries significant responsibility for officers. Therefore, it's absolutely vital that they undergo thorough training before they're authorised to carry a taser.
Excuse me, Ms Nicholl, a moment. I appreciate that people are coming into the chamber, but I'd be grateful if everyone could do so quietly. Ms Nicholl.
Therefore, it's vital that officers undergo thorough training before they're authorised to carry a taser, with a focus on de-escalation and an understanding of the incidents in which it may be appropriate to use a taser. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to outline the processes in place to ensure this is the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, taser use is limited to specially trained officers who must undergo rigorous training, and each officer to qualify to use a taser and take part in yearly refresher training in order to continue to be issued with a device. Ms Nicholl touches on an important point that given the discharge of tasers in comparison with their overall use, that would demonstrate that in very difficult situations that the presence of an officer who is trained to use a taser does actually enable the de-escalation of an incident. And furthermore to that, the deployment of tasers also allows the de-escalation of incidents from a safe distance. But, Presiding Officer, it is a complex matter where the rights and responsibilities of all has to be protected, and I'm happy to correspond further with members.